So, at the end of this contest, we need to get behind Jeremy so that our party, provides the effective, focused opposition needed to expose Tory lies and deceit. That's why I'm supporting Jeremy Corbyn, and that's why I believe he'll remain the leader of the Labour Party.
Today, we've just heard that there's yet more job losses at Camel Leds, despite them getting a very big order, laying off another 98. Tonight, we send our support to the GMB Union, doing their best to defend those jobs. But we also look at all the other struggles, many of which we've won. I see over there the campaign for the blacklisted workers, denied the possibility of working for decades by a secret cabal of employers saying they were dangerous trade unionists. Well, things have changed. We won that campaign. We won it not because of the support of the national media, but the support of ordinary people who stood up for those who speak up to defend them. Talked about the Hillsborough campaign. He's absolutely right about that. But there's some other unfinished business. We need a proper open public inquiry into what happened in Albury. And what happened in the Shrewsbury pickets as well. There are a lot of issues that we need to deal with. But this week, this past couple of weeks in Tory Britain, life hasn't been easy for a lot of people. Philip Green, minister in the Tory government, living in tax exile in Monaco, retreating to his yacht, having not paid the taxes on his company, having diminished its pension fund of the resources it needs, having driven a lot of people into a situation of being unemployed and closing all those stores. What is it about Tory Britain? What is it about the Tory government? They won't intervene to defend those jobs, but instead defend the tax evaders and the tax avoiders. Then you look at Lloyds Bank, profits gone up 101% in 1 year to over 2.5 billion. Most companies that make those levels of profits, those great profits are made on the backs of those who work. Normally they'd say, well, we'll give a bit of bonus to somebody in response. Well, what's their response? To lay off hundreds if not thousands of their workers and close their branches. Tory Britain is what it's about when the profits go up and the jobs are lost as a result of it. It should be the other way around. And a great supporter of this campaign and a great friend to all of us, pointed out in an intervention on a speech John McDonnell was making in Parliament about Shirebrook. Dennis worked there as a miner in the 1970s. It was then pay, decent pay. We went to full union membership. There was a community around the pit. There was a strength, there was a confidence about that community. Thatcher came along, the Tories came along. They were frightened of the power of the union. They were frightened of the power of industrial workers. So not caring a thing about the energy needs of this country, instead destroyed the mining industry as an act of political vandalism, as in the same. And what has then happened to that site? What has then happened to Shirebrook? It's now a zero-hours contract company, undercutting wages, an aggregate of minimum wage that doesn't even add up to a weekly minimum wage. Ambulances call, fire tenders call, in order to deal with the health and safety conditions and dangers in that factory. What is it about deregulated, high profit, unequal Tory Britain that we tolerate that kind of thing? No, no, and no. We are going to change that. So we're not going to allow them to blame the
grossly exploited workers, be they people that live down the road or migrant workers that have made their homes. We bring unity of all workers against companies like that. Workplace 2020, a policy we're developing which will require companies with more than 250 employees to negotiate with representative trade unions on wages and conditions. We will end the indignity of tribunal fees. In other words, those that have a grievance go to an employment tribunal and are in danger of losing, getting the cost of the other side put against them and no representation. It's not right. Access to justice should not be based on the and we will also deal with the scandal of the way in which legal aid has been denied to so many within our society. So many people, they can't get justice, they can't get access to legal aid. And agency workers, whoever they are, whatever they're doing, deserve the same rights as everybody else in work. We have this culture that exploits and ignorance. So we do a lot more. We want to do a lot more on employment rights and justice within our society. Because that is the basis of the inequality that exists all across modern Britain. Inequality of health is one of the worst issues facing this country. In this city, the life expectancy is the biggest gap between the richest and poorest areas of this city of any city in Britain. It's 10 years. They live in the poorer area, we live 10 years less than living in the rich area. The overall average of this city is 4 years less than the national average. Is that because doctors in Liverpool don't work as hard as those elsewhere? Is it because the residents aren't as good as elsewhere? No and no. It's all about poverty. It's all about bad habits, it's all about inequality. And the mental health crisis that's facing this country has to be addressed. One in four of us in our lifetime are going to go through a period of deep stress, mental health issues. Some of us will get through it with the love and support and affection of our friends and our family and our immediate network of workmates and others. Others won't. Others will be frightened to talk about it. Others will not be able to get any help. And sadly, some take their own lives as a result of that. We can do two things. One is change the mood music on how we deal with the issue of mental health. We change our support. Service. The Health and Social Care Act is a conveyor belt of privatisation within the National Health Service. Requiring 49% of all services put out to private contract. Not right, not necessary, and designed to reduce our great, wonderful National Health Service free at the point of use as a human right to a health service of last resort for those who can't afford it. So we stand to properly fund our National Health Service. It was founded by brave people. It was founded by a health minister in Ireland, Bevan, with vision. A vision of the idea that you were treated because you were ill, not because of the size of your wallet. Woo! That has to be the first answer. And also means properly funding adult social care so you don't end up with an email war between local government and the NHS about who will not treat somebody. Instead, you have a seamless system that treats everybody, again, irrespective of their wallets. The inequality in Britain comes in so many other areas as well. Too many children grossly overcrowded, badly maintained, expensive, damp, short-term private rented accommodation across this country. 100 years ago, Keir Hardie was the then leader of the Labour Party, campaigned against landlordism and what went with it. He wanted a world where there was security of tenure through council housing. He wanted regulation of the private rental sector. He wanted secure housing for all. Labour councils and Labour governments built a large number of council properties, gave people that security. It was the Tories under Thatcher that started the destruction of council housing and instead replacing it with a free market dogma. I tell you this, I want a Labour government that says our priority is to ensure by the end of that first term of that government, everyone is decently, securely, properly housed within our society. I give them two answers. Firstly, is anyone really very comfortable, however well off they might be themselves, to walk home of an evening, walking past homeless people begging on the streets? Or do they think there's something badly wrong with the society that is incapable of housing people and then forcing them to end up sleeping on the streets? That investment in secure housing, council housing, secure places for people to live, local authorities that do promote mortgages for first-time buyers, does help to solve the housing crisis, but it also creates a lot of very good jobs in the building industry and the supply chain as well. You can solve all our other problems at the same time. Unequal Britain devastates so many people and so many lives. Today is a sad day. It's finally the day in which the Tory government has achieved what it always wanted to. It's ended maintenance grants for students in university education. I tell you, those grants and those fee-free university places that my generation enjoyed gave many the chance to go to university from families that had never dreamt of their son or daughter going to university. And instead, it's been replaced by fee rise after fee rise, making university education impossibly expensive and debt levels frighteningly high. Why do we allow students to leave university with debts of over £50,000 a year? Other countries don't do it that way. They instead see education as something that's a good for all of us. If any one of you goes to college and becomes a good engineer, well done, you become a good engineer. Well done, all of us, we've helped you become a good engineer. We all benefit with a safer train, a safer car, a safer plane, a safer building. We all benefit from everyone's education. So can we stop treating education as a commodity and start treating it as a right everyone should have for the benefit of everyone else? A society where we do care about all. A society where we don't just educate and try to ensure they have somewhere safe to live, but also a society where we unlock the cultural potential that's there in all of us. I mentioned at the start of my speech the great Roger McGough and the Liverpool poets. There's a poet in all of us, there's a musician in all of us, there's an author in all of us. All our children need to have their hopes, their imagination unlocked and given a cultural policy that works for all. So in London, Britain, the call for the role of the matter is continuing the inequality in modern Britain. Wage levels as a proportion of national income falling, profits rising, executive pay rising, dividends rising.
Should we do something a bit different? And so, after the change in leadership of our party last year, John McDonnell announced a different economic strategy. And he called it out for what it is. Austerity is a political choice, not an economic necessity. And that political choice is being made on the backs of cuts all over the country, made on the backs of growing inequality and growing poverty for many people. Things can be different. But it's up to our party to do things differently as well. A year ago, I'm sad to say, our party was abstaining on the welfare reform.
Shame.
No more! Shame. Are we going to go down that road? No more! Is that going to be politics of our party? Our party is one that wants a society that works for all, that reduces inequality, that provides opportunities and hope for the next generation. That is what we're about. We're also about investment, fair investment across the country. Why is it that so much capital investment never leaves London or the South East, doesn't get to Merseyside, doesn't get to the North East, doesn't get to the North West? We need that investment in infrastructure, that investment that brings about the new industries, the high-tech industries, the green energy jobs, that brings about a better, more sustainable economy. It's a matter of your philosophy. Do we believe that competition is everything, or do we believe it's the role of society to invest for the good of all, not the benefit of the few? And so, when we raise all these issues, we get attacked, and we've done some analysis, and indeed independent academic analysis has been done. One newspaper, I'll leave you to guess which one it is, 84% of its stories about the Labour Party over the past year have been negative. 16% have been broadly neutral, or some would say informative. Not one story at any time in the hundreds they've printed over the past year has anything positive to say about our party. The same applies to most of the rest of the national media. Our party has been monstered by many of the journalists who should know better, and news media has been, broadcast news media has been shamelessly biased against what the Labour Party and Labour leaders and Labour Party. Social media, which is so important as a way of bypassing the monopoly of the Murdoch media. And we also reach out to each other in our communities, because in our own way, we're all leaders in our own communities. We can all help that thinking, that thought process, that idea of how society can, should and must be run very, very differently. And those that say this has been unpopular and no effect, if that's the case, how come there are now 540,000 people in Britain who are members of the Labour Party? How come that in only 48 hours, 183,000 people registered to vote in this leadership election? I'd like to tell you this, more than the entire membership of the Tory party in the whole of the UK. So when we're here in September for the Labour Party conference, let's make sure this is a conference about a confident, strong Labour Party and Labour movement, a confident and strong popular opinion that will sweep away the inequalities, the injustice, the nastiness of the free market society that only the Tories understand. That will be about unlocking that hope and that potential that's there in all of us.
Our changes didn't come about by accident. We won the right to vote in the 19th century by the bravery of the Chartists. Women got the right to vote from the bravery of the suffragettes. We got the welfare state on the backs of all those that suffered the indignities of the means test and the vile injustices of the 1930s. That generation came together to produce something better. And ever since the late 1970s, there's been a new economic philosophy abroad. In many parts of the world, the idea that you roll back the role of the public in provisions of housing, health, education, employment, industry, research, all those things, and you leave it all to the free market. It was tried in Chile, it was tried all over Latin America, it's been done in many other parts of the world, and it was done in the USA by Reagan, and it was done in Britain by Margaret Thatcher. The big movements that are now taking place across many parts of the world are about a form of politics that challenges the way in which global corporations try to dictate to us, and instead stands up for the right of democracy to decide and hope within our society. And I tell you this, in our challenges to this government, in Parliament outside, we've won quite a few things. In fact, you would have read this in most of the papers, this Tory government has been defeated 22 times in the past year alone. When they came to try to take away personal independence payments for those with disabilities, was so huge across the whole country, they were forced to withdraw it. But that is what they want to do, to return those with disabilities to the dignity of total dependence rather than the hope of independence that can be given by society that cares. So it is about how we approach these things that so say to those people struggling in poverty, those children growing up in poor quality housing, those who are better off but nevertheless want to live in a more decent, more equal society, and those that recognise we have to deal with the environmental issues facing this planet in a sensible, serious and connected way. And I'm fed up with young people being told, sorry, you can't have the advantages your parents' generation had, because we can no longer afford the university education, the college education, the good quality apprenticeships and all the things that you need. And by the way, the generation that comes after you will get even less than you. And I ask myself this question: this planet is incalculably wealthier than it was 20 years ago, 40 years ago, 80 years ago, 100 years ago. Technology has moved on at an amazing pace. Can't we use that technology, that brilliance, that science, that engineering, and all those things to share wealth rather than of the attacks on industrial workers in the 80s. We're strengthened by that. We're strengthened by our resolve. We're strengthened by our determination. We're above all strengthened by our collective hope. Coming together, working together, not blaming each other or blaming minorities. That gives us hope. That gives us opportunity. That gives us a world of justice, peace and human rights. Thank you.
Young lady behind us, down there. Yeah, she's the one there. Yeah, that's the one. thank you. Well done.
We're going to have to work very hard together to get the resources necessary for the city to build the country.
Oh, Cutting short
stuff.
Yes.
Oh, so
absolutely.
Sure.
Have you got a pen?
Yeah.
Someone had a Sharpie went before. Someone had a you need a Sharpie.
Oh, we've got them.
They won't do an ordinary pen, you need like a Sharpie or something like that.
In our area we don't. We've lost them.
Hello carbonisters. When they insist he's just not good enough. Well, we know better. Just look them in the eyes and say, we're voting for them anyway.
Just keep going.
Hold on.